Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to St. Paul Lutheran Church and School. Glad that you are here on this snowy morning. You know, this is the first time that being in Fort Dodge, I get to see 10 inches here, 8 to 10 inches. So it's been a very interesting last couple days for all of us as we are reminded of the forgiveness that we have, that we are as white as snow before our God. And so we're thankful for that. If you are listening to us on 1400 AM, Moment with God, we welcome you as we are going to be continuing on with our sermon series. Our sermon series is about our vision. A couple weeks ago, we began our sermon series. Pastor John was with us. He had began to ask the question, what is a vision? And then last week, we started talking about part of the vision that we have, which is to glorify God. And as we glorify God, what does that mean as we glorify God in all of that we do? The second half of our vision is to impact the community by being the heart, hand, and feet of Jesus. And so today I will be focusing on what does it mean to have the heart of Jesus? What does it mean for us to have that heart of Jesus? I look forward to sharing that with you. If you're joining us online, we're thankful that you are here with us also, as I do have a few announcements. First of all, Pastor John requests that you would have him in your prayers. He had appendicitis a few days ago and had his appendix taken out, and so he is at home recovering from that surgery. And so he just asked for you to pray for him for his recovery. We'll be sure to have that in the prayers for our time together for the prayers of the church. Also, just a reminder about the shoe collection. The youth are collecting gently used and even new shoes and even sandals to be able to get a goal of 100 bags of 25 pairs of shoes in each bag. So that kicks off this weekend, and we will continue on until the middle of February. And what you can do is you can bring those shoes in. There is a table that is out in the narthex, out in the gathering area, that you can certainly drop off your shoes there, either during service or during Sundays or the weekend when we have service, or you can come through during the week in regards to that. Also, Lutheran Schools Week begins January 23rd, and we will be having the kids singing at the 10:30 service on the 23rd. But after that, the ladies of St. Paul are putting together a meal. It's a luncheon. It'll be scalloped potatoes and ham, and so be sure that you have an opportunity to come here. That'll be a fundraiser for the National Youth Gathering. So please keep in mind that on January 23rd, you don't have to worry about lunch. You can just come right over here at noon for the luncheon. Now, some of you may be asking and wondering about how did my Mayo visit go. And so I went up the Mayo on Monday and Tuesday. If you could go to the next screen, you can see there's an outline of an ear. You can see the circle there where the inner ear is located. The lower part of that area, it looks like a snail. That's actually the cochlea. Right above it is my surgeon called it was sound tunnels. So the sound goes into the eardrum, goes through the sound tunnels down into the cochlea, and then is taken out to the auditory nerve. And so in my right ear, what we found out was when you have meningitis, the inflammation in meningitis, when it goes away, it leaves scar tissue, and that scar tissue is bone. And so the tunnels that are above the cochlea, the sound tunnels there, they are completely filled with bone. And that's why I can't hear in this right ear. What they did find out, though, is in the right ear, the cochlea, what he called the front door, which is where the canals go into the cochlea, that had bone, but the rest of the cochlea is completely open, which means that I'll be able to have a cochlear implant put in on my right side, and I'll be able to hear in my right ear for the first time in my life. So I'm very excited about that opportunity. Now, what I will hear, I don't know. They said environmental sounds,
I'll be able to hear, whether I can hear speech or not, I'm not sure. But I know that from now on, as I'm preaching, nobody on this side can be snoring during that time, because I'll be able to hear you, okay? Okay, so keep that in mind. They also found out that in my left ear, I still have calcification or bone, a little bit of bone in the sound canal. But as you get older, it starts to crystallize even more, and that's why my hearing is getting worse as I get older. And so my cochlea is completely open on that side, so I'm a good candidate to have a cochlear implant on that side also. So on March 9th, which will be a Wednesday, on March 9th, I will have a double cochlear implant put in. And so I ask for your prayers as we prepare for that. I'm a little nervous about it, but I also know that it'll be an exciting time for us. I want you to also realize that over the next month, I'll be preparing you. What will you see when you see me with the cochlear implant? What does that look like? What to expect as I'm trying to remap the whole auditory world again, and those kinds of things. So we'll be keeping you informed to prepare for that particular service, that surgery, because not only will it prepare you, but it'll prepare me too for that time. So we're thankful for that opportunity, and thank God for the miracle of being able to have the cochlear implant. So with that, why don't we go ahead and wave to each other? We're thankful to be in worship together as we begin with our opening hymn, Songs of Thankfulness and Praise.
Thank you.
morning, we'll be following the Vita hymn service as we recognize the second weekend after Epiphany. And so we begin with the opening versicle. Won't you stand with me? This is the day which the Lord had made. From the rising of the sun to its setting. Out of Zion, the perfection of beauty, God shined forth. Prepare the way of the Lord. Shower, O heaven, from above, and let the skies rain down righteousness. From the rising of the sun to its setting. We say together, glory be to the Father, and to the Son,
and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
We continue on with the singing of the Kyrie and the Gloria. We pray. Almighty and everlasting God, who governs all things in heaven and on earth, mercifully hear the prayers of your people and grant us your peace through all our days. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lived and reigned with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated. Our first reading for our time together this morning comes to us from the Old Testament, comes to us from the book of Isaiah, chapter 51. And here we see in the word of Isaiah that God had compassion on us, that he seeks to comfort us. Look to Abraham, your father, and to Sarah, who bore you, for he was but one when I called him. that I might bless him and multiply him. For the Lord comfort Zion. He comforts all her waste places and makes her wilderness like Eden, her desert like the garden of the Lord. Joy and gladness will be found in her, thanksgiving and the voice of song. Give attention to me, my people, and give ear to me, my nation. For a law will go out from me, and I will set my justice for a light to the people. This is the word of the Lord. Our second reading for this morning comes to us from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 12. And here we see Paul talking about spiritual gifts. The fact that we think about having the heart of Jesus, that through the Holy Spirit, God gives us gifts that enables us to do so. And here Paul emphasizes those spiritual gifts. Paul writes, "Now concerning spiritual gifts, brothers, I do not want you to be uninformed. You know that when you were pagans, you were led astray to mute idols, however you were led. Therefore, I want you to understand that no one speaking in the Spirit of God ever said Jesus is accursed. And no one can say Jesus is Lord except in the Holy Spirit. Now, there are a variety of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of service, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who empowers them all in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. To one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by the one Spirit. To another, the working of miracles. To another, prophecy. To another, the ability to distinguish between spirits. To another, various kinds of tongues. To another, the interpretation of tongues. All these are empowered by one and the same Spirit, who apportions to each one individually as he wills." This is the word of the Lord. Won't you stand with me in honor of the gospel? The Holy Gospel this morning comes to us from Matthew chapter 9. "And Jesus went throughout all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom and healing every disease and every affliction. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, 'The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest.'" This is the gospel of the Lord. We continue on with our sermon hymn, "It Spread the Reign of God the Lord," hymn 830. We will go ahead and sing the first four verses before the message. You may be seated.
Thank you.
Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God, our Heavenly Father, and from our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus, our Christ. Grace to you who here are in the sanctuary, to those of you that are online, those of you that are listening to the radio. This time last year, we began to ask the question within the leadership, what does it mean to achieve our mission? Our mission is making disciples. Disciples of Christ, making disciples for Christ. And we began to ask the question, what does it mean for us to do that? What does it look like? After all, we can't change the mission. That's Matthew chapter 28. We are called to be disciples of Christ, making disciples for Christ. But what does it look like as we seek to achieve that here at St. Paul Lutheran Church and School? The leadership came together and we came to a point that we came to the voters and we voted that the way that it looks for us to make disciples is that we glorify God as we do so and that we have the heart, hands, and feet of Jesus as we seek to impact our communities. So now we're breaking that down. What does it mean for us to have the heart? What does it mean for us to have the hand? What does it mean for us to have the feet of Jesus? And so today we focus on the heart of Jesus. What does it mean for us to have the heart of Jesus? When my daughter, Michaela, my oldest one, was about 8, 9 years old, we were about ready to go to school, and I got into the car, and I got her all situated, and I turned on the car, and the radio came on, and this is the song that came onto the radio. The Beatles, the Eleanor Rigby. And after the song was done, my daughter, in the back seat, she pipes up and she said, "Dad, what happened to all those lonely people?" You see, she was reflecting a care. She was reflecting a concern for lonely people. And as I was preparing this message, that's a glimpse of what it's about in having the heart of Jesus. As we think about having the heart of Jesus, it means that we have a care, that we have a caring heart. Not just individually, but also it means here at St. Paul Lutheran Church and School, it is about having a heart of Jesus. For you see, as we have a heart for Jesus, as we care for those, not just in our congregation in school, but we care for those in our community, we can have an impact as we do that. So the question is what did it mean for us to be caring? What did it mean for us to have a caring heart? What did it mean for us to have a heart of Jesus? So in typical fashion for me, I boiled it down to 3 points. 3 important qualities that a caring person has based on Scripture as we look to Jesus. Jesus is our embodiment of what it means to be a caring person. And so we see that the first one is that at the heart of Jesus, we have compassion. As we think about having the heart of Jesus, we have compassion. That word compassion is written all over the Old and New Testament. We even saw it in our first reading in the Old Testament where God seeks to comfort, to have compassion. We see it in the New Testament, and if we just stick with the New Testament, in fact, if we just stick with the Gospel of Matthew, there are 3 different incidences that I can point to where Jesus himself has compassion. Matthew chapter 20, we see that Jesus is walking on the road, and on the side of the road were two blind men. And the two blind men start to cry out to Jesus, but the crowd is trying to quiet them. But Jesus heard them, and he walked over to them, and this is what the scriptures say. Jesus had compassion on them, and he touched their eyes. Immediately, they received their sight. We see in chapter 14 that Jesus had been putting in some long days. He was tired. He was worn out. He was looking forward to just having some private time. He was looking forward to taking some days off and even to spend some time with his disciples. And so they crossed over the lake, and as they crossed over to the lake, to an area that they thought they would be able to get away from it all, there a crowd was waiting for Jesus. And despite how tired he was, despite of his own plans, this is what it says about how Jesus reacts. When Jesus landed, he saw the large crowd. He had compassion on them and healed their sick. One more from Matthew chapter 9, was our gospel reading for today. That is, Jesus was traveling through the countryside. After all, his ministry only lasted 3 years. He needed to be able to touch as many people as he could. He went through, he was traveling from synagogue to synagogue, preaching the message. And yet, everywhere he traveled, he would look at the people, and this is what we read. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless. They were like sheep without a shepherd. My point is that if you want to know what compassion is, we can look to Jesus. That if we seek to have the heart of Jesus, it means to have compassion. Now, what does compassion mean? What's the definition of compassion? Compassion, its word itself, means a deep emotional response. In fact, in the Old Testament, compassion actually meant the woman's womb. Something that is so internally, inside, in your gut area, to have that deep emotional impact in your gut. In other words, when it said that Jesus had compassion on the people and on the crowds and on individuals, it means that his heart was ripped out from him, that he had an angst and he had a yearning for his people, and that he hurt with his people and felt their pain. To say that to have the heart of Jesus means for us that we react with a deep emotional response. That we just don't care, but yet we care to a point that our hearts break for those in need. Not just here in the community, that's not just here in the congregation in school, but in all of our circles of influence, being able to have compassion. The second thing about, as we seek to have the heart of Jesus, as we seek to show care to those, that not only is compassion important, but compassion is always linked to action. When you are looking in Scripture, when Jesus has compassion, it is always linked to action. You see, caring for someone is more than just knowing someone is having a challenge in their life and then just saying, oh, that's too bad. Having compassion, I mean, that leads us to do something about it. In other words, if you know that your neighbor is going through an ugly divorce, it's not just about saying, oh, that's too bad that they're going through it, but being available to go over and to spend time with them, to listen to them, to encourage them. In fact, compassion linked with action, the most effective way that we can do that is to give our time. Caring people are willing to give their time. And there's no more dramatic way to show that you care for someone by giving an individual our time. Yeah, sure, we are busy, but Jesus was busy. We have a full schedule. Jesus had a full schedule. So it's not any different today than it was at the time of Jesus. It's just being able to take time out for someone, to listen to them and to spend time with them. A dramatic way that you can show that is if your daughter comes up to you or your granddaughter comes up to you and says, I'd like for you to see this, or I'd like to talk to you about this. And you're in the middle of watching the Hawkeye football game. For you to be able to say, yes, I'll listen to you. I'll spend some time with you. Instead of saying, I'll talk to you later, I'll see you later, and we can talk about it then. Being able to spend time right now with a person. And that's important for us as a congregation and school. For us not only to spend time with one another, but also to look for ways that we can spend time with people who are in need in the community. Have you noticed someone that hasn't been in worship in a while? Have you ever wondered what's happening with them? What's going on with them? Don't just leave it up to the pastor to try to reach out to them. But you can also take time. It's part of compassion that you wonder, you are caring enough to even recognize that they are not in worship and to have an opportunity to link that compassion with action by being able to reach out and say, hey, I've just been thinking about you. What's been going on in your life? How are things going with you? So to have a heart of Jesus means compassion. It means also compassion linked with action. And the second thing that we can think about as we think about having the heart of Jesus is that we have a care of forgiveness. If we go to the next slide, the heart of Jesus that we care through forgiveness. If the most dramatic way that you can care for someone is by spending time with them, the most powerful way that you can demonstrate care is through forgiveness. Because you see, my friend, forgiveness costs something for each and every one of us. If somebody has hurt us, if somebody has insulted us, if somebody has done something wrong to us, it cost us something to be able to forgive that person. After all, what do we want? We want to be able to seek revenge. We want some kind of retribution. We want some kind of justice. We deal with anger for that person. But moving toward forgiveness cost us something. It cost us to lay down our anger, to lay down our desire for justice, to lay down our desire for retribution, but simply to forgive. You know, I came across a perfect example of what that would look like. Let's say you had some people come over to your house for dinner. And this probably would never happen, but let's say those people decided to get up and get a baseball and play catch in the middle of your dining room or in the middle of your house. And as they're doing that, they're throwing the ball and they miss it and it breaks your favorite china, or it breaks a family heirloom, it breaks some other things in the house. And afterward, they are deeply sorry for what they've done, and they want to go ahead and replace it. But instead, what you say is, That's okay. I've got it. Well, isn't that exactly what God had done for us? That in the midst of our sin, we had broken our relationship with Him, that we have hurt Him, and that we continue to go against what He would have us do, to the point where He was willing to send His Son to a cross. That while on the cross, all of our sins and our guilt were placed upon Him, so that He would say, "That's okay, I got it." His words were, "It is finished." That all of our sins and guilt would die with Him on the cross, so that we can be forgiven. Forgiven of the thing that we've done. And that is the compassion that God has for us. A compassion to know that we are separated from Him because of our sin and to take care of that separation through His Son, Jesus Christ. That Jesus embodies that care. And if we're going to say that we're going to have the heart of Jesus, that means that we understand that people need to know that there is a God who cares about them. Especially now, in these times. Over 36,000 people take their life every year because they don't think anybody cares for them. And for us to be able to have the opportunity that with the heart of Jesus, that as we've been touched by God's love and compassion and kindness and care, that we can then show that same compassion and kindness and care to one another here at St. Paul Lutheran Church and School and in the community. And as we do, our vision will become even more reality. And that we, through having a heart of Jesus, will truly make an impact. Amen. Now may the peace of God that passes all of our understanding keep our hearts and our minds in the one true faith until life everlasting. Amen. We continue on with the last two verses of our hymn. Our Heavenly Father has had compassion on us to give us the faith through the gift of His Holy Spirit that enables us to say we believe in God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And so we have the opportunity to confess our faith, and we will do so in song to the tune of Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise. Won't you stand with me?
Thank you.
At that time, we have the opportunity to give thanks to God by giving back to him a portion of that which he's given us, to us through our tithe and offering. You may be seated. Won't you stand with me in prayer? Gracious Heavenly Father, we are humbled. We are humbled that you would continue to care for us. We are humbled for the compassion that you have for us. We ask that you would bless these gifts that we bring to you, that we know that all that we have comes from your hand and you give it to us at the proper time. We ask that you would continue to lead us and guide us, that we would use these gifts to put forth your mission and your vision, to be disciples of Christ, making disciples for Christ, and doing so as we glorify you and as we make an impact in our community. We pray this in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen. Gracious Heavenly Father, we prayed you that you had restored creation through the shedding of Christ's blood, that you poured out your grace in abundance, and you continue to do so today. Give us joy and gladness in the revelation of your truth and the compassion that you have shown to each of us through the person of your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of glory, we ask that you would preserve your Son's bride, the church. Make it her constant joy and delight to preach the good news of forgiveness and the compassion that you have shown. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of glory, we praise you for the promise of your presence. And we are honored that you would give us that promise. We ask that you would strengthen and give your gladness and your presence to all married couples, that you also would give your presence and your comfort and gladness to those that are single and to all families. Be present in our homes and live knowing that you give us a free and abundant forgiveness and preserve us in the true faith from each generation to the next. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of glory, you rule this world by your power. Give to our civil servant respect and recognition of your creation and its nature. When they use the authority given to them from above, let it be in accord with your good design for our world and not the corruption of sin. which they are to rebuke for the good of their citizen. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of glory, we bring before you the sick and the distressed and the needy. We lift up to you Kathy McNeil, Connie Burbank, June Saxton, Pastor John, Troy Hoyer, Barb Rather, Lonnie Gherkin, Gary Anderson, Dale Gherkin, Tom Mernach, Vernon Singlinger, Myra Asmus, Dave Carlson, Gerald Hunch, and Gerald Gehring. We also ask, Heavenly Father, that you would be with those who are grieving, especially the family of Lawrence Hunch, who had passed away and will be laid to rest tomorrow. For the family of Kathleen Barone, a former teacher here at our school who had passed away last week. That you would be with the family of Dwayne Johnson, to be with Gladys and the family, that Dwayne had passed away on Friday. That you would be with the family of Pastor Charles Horkey, and also to be with Faith Lutheran in Sioux City as they grieve the loss of their pastor. We ask, Heavenly Father, that in the midst of grief, that your compassion would be made known, and that your presence would be felt. That we ask that you would give your abiding comfort in every circumstance, that in Christ we know that we shall not die but live and declare his works. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. Lord of glory, you transform water into wine, and so manifest yourself to us here, as we know that in, with, and under the bread and wine is the very body and blood for the forgiveness of our sins. And make us fit partakers in repentance and faith. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hand, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
O Lord Jesus Christ, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sin. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." My friend, may the peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
Won't you stand with me if you are able? Now may the true body and blood of our Lord and Savior both strengthen you now in your body and soul and unto life everlasting. Amen. Let's pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy, that you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lived and reigned with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give each and every one of you his peace.
Amen.
We continue on with our closing hymn, Hark the Voice of Jesus Calling, hymn 827. You may be seated. As you leave the sanctuary this morning, please keep in mind that God has shown you compassion, and we have the opportunity for us to have the heart of Jesus to show compassion to those around us and make an impact. We do have Ken Hendricks is going to be coming up. He is going on a mission trip in about a week, and he wanted to share that mission trip with you real quick and be able to talk with you in regard to that. This battery ran out, so I'm going to go up and get another battery. You can go ahead and start talking, and I'll be right back.
This morning kind of fits perfectly. Half of Brown, Waxhaw, North Carolina, in the 90s, went to Nicaragua. And seeing the poverty, the lack of education, and definitely the lack of gospel being preached, went home, took his life savings, went back to Managua, found a little village called Chacalbe on the southwest corner of Managua and built a compound there. Has a school, a church, a large warehouse to
hold food supplies for distribution to villages in need. It also has boarding rooms, most with air conditioning and some with hot water, so if you care to join me, there is a place to stay. A couple weeks ago, Patrick Brown, his son, who now runs the ministry down there, called me, wanted me to come down. We are going to go the first week in February to one of the, I think, three indigenous tribes of Nicaragua. And I'm going to murder this name, but it's Mayangna. I'll let you pronounce that. There's 15,000 people in this tribe. They have one church. The first trip that he made up there some time ago, a lady and three children died of starvation before he got there. There's a serious need for ministry, for helping with food supply, which is getting pretty hard to do the last couple of years in Nicaragua. The Christian organization that was helping clear containers of food coming from the United States used to get them through customs for $3,500. Well, a few years ago when they had all the riots and stuff, they pulled out. It is now costing somewhere around $8,500, and it takes months in bribe money to get it done. So there is a serious need. We're purchasing a piece of ground, 17 acres, for about $8,000. It's going to cost around $5,000 to build a building to start a ministry. And the week trip up there, it's 2 days travel both ways, is going to be somewhere around $1,500 for vehicles and people to go and get this accomplished. So, that being said, Perry Brown definitely had the heart of Jesus.